Pokemon Nuzlockes are a way of making the game 10 times harder. By being limited to only the first Pokemon you catch on a route and no Pokemon fainting for the entirety of the run, otherwise they're dead, it's one of the most popular Pokemon challenges for good reason. However, in my 20 plus years of playing Pokemon, I have never attempted a Nuzlocke, until now. This is the story of how I beat my first Pokemon Nuzlocke in Brilliant Diamond. And consider subscribing if you haven't already. Alright, let's skip all the introduction stuff. You're here to see how I actually beat this Nuzlocke, so which starter Pokemon did I pick? And luckily, I went with the best option for this Nuzlocke, Chimchar. Chimchar is easily the best starter for Sinnoh because for the first two gyms, it's super effective against both. And that's when your options for Pokemon are the most limited. I got my Chimchar and somehow it was a girl, which was really rare, and I named it Loco. So if you've played any Sinnoh game, then you'll know that the options for Pokemon around here are really limited with only Pokemon like Bidoof, Bidoo, Starly, Shinx. So I'm just gonna skip over the next couple of encounters. I made my way to Jubilife City, caught a Bidoo, fought my rival, was way easier than expected, made my way through Ravage Pass, and then stumbled upon Aurberg City. So I haven't fully explained the rules of my Nuzlocke. I'm not doing a hardcore Nuzlocke because this is literally my first Nuzlocke I've ever done. So other rules you may be thinking, like no healing, I'm allowed to heal, because if other trainers can do it, I can do it. And I'm playing on set mode, which I never do. Before planning to fight Rourke, I had to get Loco to evolve into a Monferno because it also learns Power Up Punch, which is a move that gets stronger every time you use it. So after a bit of training, my little fire monkey evolved into and also a little fire monkey, but a bit cooler. Or I guess hotter. Alright, scratch this. Alright, first gym time. Oh wait, it's already over? I swept his whole team with Power Up Punch. So the next couple moments before the second gym requires a lot of Team Galactic battles, so I will be covering these. Most of them. The next big threat in this challenge is Marza's Perugly, which is an instrumental Pokemon to face this early in the game and is incredibly powerful. However, I had an idea. So I caught a Starly earlier in the game, and since then it evolved into Staravia as you just saw before. I named it Hedwig because of the cool Harry Potter reference. But this Pokemon is the savior of this Mars battle for the sole reason that Staravia can have Intimidate. Luxio can also have Intimidate, but mine's Rivalry, so that sucks. So if I just send in Staravia after beating Mars' Zubat, which is really easy, then I'm good. I taught Hedwig the move Pluck, which would come in really handy in this challenge, and then it was time to face Mars. Not without mentioning I caught a Magikarp as well, which I'll explain later. Mars time! Zubat was a cakewalk, and then it was time for the Perugly. My strategy of bringing Hedwig in was not only genius, it was one of the best strategies I had without realizing how good it was, because Pluck takes away Perugly's Oranberry, and Hedwig's Intimidate really made this Perugly so weak. So yeah, we beat Mars. I then entered Eterna Forest where I caught my next encounter, Buniri, which I nicknamed Waifu because why not? I almost lost my Buizel named Finn to a double Abra Energy Ball, but if I didn't know they had Energy Ball, I would have lost it. I luckily switched. And here's the most exciting thing about this challenge. Alright, let's not sugarcoat it. The Grand Underground is one of the best things in Brilliant Diamond and Shining Pearl. This expansive underground gives you so many great Pokemon encounters that I really didn't know how to come by this idea of, do I catch one Pokemon in the underground or do I catch multiple? So I came up with the idea that I can catch one Pokemon for each badge I obtain. So I can catch 8 underground Pokemon in total at any given order. I don't need 8 gym badges for 8 Pokemon. I can have one gym badge and just have 8 underground encounters. But with that said, I had to choose very wisely about my encounters here. I caught an Abra earlier, so I evolved into Kadabra and I traded it to get an Alakazam very early on. And then I met the Queen of Pokemon herself. Okay, look, I get that Cynthia is a very attractive woman, however she is my favorite Pokemon character of all time. Not for that reason, but because her team is so freaking powerful, I don't know how I'm gonna get through this challenge. Why is there still romantic music playing? Can we stop? I'm actually trying to have a serious moment here. So to put it out there, trainers in this game aren't like normal Pokemon trainers. They actually have sometimes perfect EV Pokemon. So if you have a Pokemon that's level 25 against another Pokemon that's level 25, if it's a specific trainer, that Pokemon can be stronger than yours. This is one of the harder Pokemon games to Nuzlocke because Pokemon can even have hidden abilities. I arranged a date with Cynthia, strolled around the Grand Underground for a bit, and then went to face Gardenia. I used Power Up Punch on the Cherubi and then immediately swept her team. Now it's time for Jupiter, and she isn't nearly as difficult as Mars. She does have a Skuntank with Flamethrower, however, I have a Monferno. I can take that hit. Basically just relied on Hedwig to use Intimidate to lower the attack stat of Skuntank, and I won pretty easily. I met the leader of Team Galactic, who isn't crazy at all, and then I was given the ability to walk with my Pokemon, and I had some fun done with that. I then had to battle my rival again, who was a cakewalk. He's easy, like what else can I say? At least he gave me the necessary experience to evolve my Magikarp into the powerful Gyarados. Alright, so if you don't know, Gyarados is possibly the best Pokemon to use in a Nuzlocke. Because it can have Intimidate, which is already really good in and of itself, Gyarados is a very powerful Pokemon to have at the very low level of 20. My team was now looking really good for Pokemon I just caught in a Nuzlocke. And additionally, Blossom the Badoo finally evolved into Roselia. After raising the friendship enough on Blossom, I brought Waifu back to hopefully get my Lopunny sometime soon. Oh, it's hopping, this is so cute. I caught a Chansey, then traveled to Celesion Town. Oh look, now I'm in Velstone City, really, time does fly. I was really excited to go to Velstone City because Pokemon included a bunch of really nice TMs in the department store, and I feel like I could really use some of them. Especially since Infernape really takes a long time to learn Flamethrower, might as well just buy it. After going through an absurd amount of trainer battles, Finn finally evolved into a Floatzel. I then found my next encounter, a Girafarig, which was something I was actually really excited for because I knew it would come in really handy against Fantina. Oh yeah, I named her Gallop. I then went searching in the Grand Underground for a bit where I found an Absol. I decided to catch it because I knew it was a strong Pokemon and it could come in handy against Fantina with Girafarig, who knows? I named her Angel and then I found a Scyther and I knew I had to have Scizor on the team because Scizor is one of the best Pokemon to use in a Nuzlocke as well as Gyarados. I caught it, named it Nitro, and found out it had an adamant nature which was perfect. Alright, now it's time for Maylene. So Maylene has a Lucario which has Bulk Up, which if you didn't know raises its attack and defense, so if I use a Pokemon like Gyarados or even Hedwig, I don't know if I can stand a chance against this thing. And the problem is Drain Punch restores Lucario, so I'm in a bit of a pickle with what I should do here. I had Houdini the Alakazam set up a Reflect just in case the Lucario actually goes for a physical move first. I one-shot both her Meditite and Machoke, and then she sent out her strongest Pokemon. Lucario immediately bulks up, and then it's a game of sending in Hydra and Hedwig, so it lowers Lucario's attack enough, but the problem is Bulk Up raises its defense, so Bulldoze barely does anything. I was convinced I'd lose a Pokemon, but luckily Houdini's Confusion actually did half of Lucario's health, and since Houdini outspeeds Lucario, I attacked it again and I luckily won the fight. I found my next encounter, Shellos, which was fantastic because Gastrodon is such a strong Pokemon and only weak to one type. I was very excited about this and named it Slugette. I made it to Pastoria City, where I think I'm comfortable to face the fourth gym. Alright, it's time for Crash Awake. Due to the fact that my Luxio has a Rival Ring ability, it's not going to be that very helpful in this gym. So instead, I relied on my Hydra. Gyarados turned out to be the perfect counter to his Floatzel because all he could really do was Ice Fang, and I managed to defeat him with just a few crunches. So you might be wondering to yourself, Lucas, this is a Nuzlocke. You're meant to lose Pokemon. Well, actually, I didn't lose a Pokemon for the first four gyms in a row. But that would all change with the first death. Oh my god, it's you again. All right, I have to talk about this. There is a member of a villainous team roaming around and I'm trying to catch them and Barry just decides to come up and fight you. Where are his priorities? To be a better Pokemon trainer or to not die? I'm guessing the first. So I was going about my day when these two ace trainers spot me, and keep in mind these are optional trainers and they turn out to have very strong Pokemon in Gyarados and Raichu. I switched to Leah the Luxio to hopefully tank some of the Gyarados' hits. Unfortunately, Raichu's Thunderbolt did way more than I was expecting, and then the Gyarados waterfalls Leah and kills her. This was the first death of the Nuzlocke. I love Luxray. I think it's one of the coolest Sinnoh Pokemon, and Luxio I was really excited to use in this Nuzlocke. However, there are a couple reasons why I'm not too upset about Leah's death. For one, it wasn't even a Luxray and not a main team member, and two, Leah had the Rivalry ability, which really, really sucked. So this death does suck, but it's not the only one that happens. I made it to Celestic Town, where I had to give the old charm to Cynthia's grandmother. Oh hey, Cyrus, was it? You're totally not planning to destroy the world, right? Oh, would you look at that, Hedwig evolved into Staraptor. Oh, and it looks like Loco evolved into an Infernape. Big power buff on the team. I then went to the underground to do a little bit more training for Fantina. Slughead evolved into a beautiful Gastrodon, and then this happened. I was facing a wild Munchlax in the underground. I wasn't paying attention that Munchlax screeched me two times, and I lost Blossom. Blossom's death wasn't for nothing though, because I've happened to find a Togepi, and this gave me an idea. So Roselia evolves into Roserade with a shiny stone, but Togetic evolves into Togekiss also with a shiny stone. And because Blossom died, this gave me an idea to use Togekiss. I've never really used Togekiss in a playthrough, and it would actually be pretty cool. I named my Togepi Pixie, and now it's time for possibly the hardest gym leader in the game, Fantina. I sent out Angel to hopefully KO the Drifblim easily. She did just that, but then Gengar came out, and I was convinced that Angel could live one Dazzling Gleam from Gengar, even though Absol wasn't at full HP. I was wrong, and Angel died. I went from having no deaths in this playthrough to having 3 in a row after the 4th gym, and I was convinced I'd lose a Pokemon against Fantina, and if it was any Pokemon, I suppose Angel was the best bet to die. I feel really bad saying that. With the help from Gallop the Giraffe Rig, I was able to pull off a win against Fantina, but not without losing a brave member of the party. I went to Iron Island, where I found Riley, teamed up with him, defeated a few Galactic Grunts in the meantime. Waifu finally learned to love me and became low punny, and then it was time to battle Byron. Now, typically, Byron is really difficult because his Bastiodon knows of the move Metal Burst. However, in these remakes, doesn't have Metal Burst, so actually Byron was maybe the easiest gym leader ever. After dealing with Team Galactic for a bit, I had to go to Snowpoint City, so through the snowy routes of Sinnoh. These are long and hail is annoying, but it's pretty easy if you use the right Pokemon. And being in the snow actually really gave me an idea. I could catch a Swinub, which would be instrumental against Cynthia's Garchomp, because Garchomp doesn't have any super effective move against Mamoswine. As long as Mamoswine lives a hit, I can use a move like Avalanche to deal double damage. And I can also get myself a Garchomp. Alright, Candace time. Now Candace typically has a Medicham, which has pure power, which means it can do a lot of damage even if it's intimidated by my Gyarados. This is a battle I was extremely nervous for, however I gave Loco the Metronome item, which means every time it uses something like Flamethrower, it deals more damage if I keep using that move in succession. So what did I do? I swept her team just using Flamethrower. I went back down to the underground to get myself a Swinub, which I will admit took longer than expected to find, but I called it Permafrost, which is a cool name. And I found my Gibble, which I called Jawdrop. So now it's time for the Galactic Headquarters, and basically the end of the Galactic storyline for Brilliant Diamond and Shining Pearl. And now I have to battle Cyrus for like the control of time and space or whatever. Oh, look, he's defeated. That was easy. I made my way to the top of Spear Pillar, where pretty much havoc happens when Cyrus just brings Dialga here and captures it in a red chain. Oh, would you look at that? The God of Time is freed, and someone is angry. Holy sh! Alright, Cyrus round 2. Usually Cyrus is really difficult because he has a Gyarados that has Earthquake. However, since I have my own Gyarados, this battle was pretty easy. Yo, can someone just put this dude in jail? I guess it's time to face Dialga, the God of Time. I caught it and I named it Palkia, because it's a perfect name. After that craziness, I finally got my Scizor and ready to challenge the 8th gym. I did some training and I evolved Gibble and Swinub into Garchomp and Mamoswine. I was now ready to face Volkner, and I'm not going to sugarcoat it. Volkner was pretty easy. He has 2 Pokemon that are actually electric types, and then when you have an Ambipom and Octillery, it doesn't really pose much of a threat against my team. So ultimately, I won and I earned my 8th badge. Okay, this is where I stopped playing for a couple days, and the biggest reason why, the Pokemon League terrified me. This is maybe the toughest Pokemon League in any main series game, for the sole reason that, as I said earlier on in the video, Pokemon are like competitively perfect, have great held items, great abilities, fantastic move sets. So if I went into the Elite Four and Champion, I can't use any other Pokemon than the 6 I have there, so I need to try and craft a team that can handle the Pokemon League, as well as Cynthia. And I think we should bring back a member we spoke about before in Pixie, the Togepi. I'm not going to bother you guys with the amount of grinding I had to go through for this. My Pokemon were all basically at level 63 or 64. Movesets were improved. I have Togekiss in my team, and this is my party as a whole for the Pokemon League. I have no idea if I'm going to be able to win. I have no idea if this is even enough, but you know what? I have to try. Aaron is the easiest Elite Four. I had an idea where if I just use the Metronome item again on Loco, I can just annihilate his team, and that's essentially what I did, but until the Drapion outspeeds and went for Earthquake. However, it only did under half, and I KO'd Drapion. Bertha was up next, and she had a more of a difficult team. I couldn't just spam a metronome item. Instead, I actually had to carefully strategize what Pokemon I was going to use. Moves like Grass Knot on Pixie and Gyarados actually really carried this battle, and before you know it, Hydra pulled out the win. Moving on to Flint, he was a bit of a pushover. His team was not that difficult, I will say. Pokemon like Rapidash, Lopunny, Steelix really fell to some of the Pokemon I had on my own team. Now, Drifblim has no attacking moves, but has set up moves so it can Baton Pass into Flint's Infernape, which is a hidden ability Iron Fist Infernape. However, if I taunt the Drifblim, which I did, Drifblim can't attack and just use Struggle, and my other Pokemon can handle Infernape. Drifblim and Infernape both fell, and then it was time for the final Elite Four member, Lucian. And I set up plus 6 with Sword Stance and swept his team with Sizzle. There was only one more trainer stopping me from becoming the Pokemon champion and succeeding in winning my first Nuzlocke. However, this is Cynthia, and I have no idea what I'm gonna do, but I'm only left with really one choice to guarantee a victory. Cynthia sends out Spiritomb first, and I lead with Nitro, and really the only strategy I had for this battle was unfortunately to set up with Sword Stance once again and sweep her team. There's two problems here. One, I have no idea if Sizzle can even live a hit from Spiritomb, or at least take under half damage to be able to set up even more so I can heal. And two, I don't even know if plus 6 will be enough to take down Garchomp. Luckily, Nitro was able to get to plus 6 and use Bullet Punch, and this is where the Nuzlocke changed. One by one, Cynthia's team fell to Nitro until the Garchomp came out. This is the Pokemon that has been giving players the most difficult time when facing Cynthia, and I was left with no other option to sack Nitro. Garchomp would seem to be able to live a plus 6 Bullet Punch, and the only other option is to sack Nitro and bring in a Pokemon like Hydra or Pixie. And then it happened. I was able to win my very first Pokemon Nuzlocke against one of the most difficult Pokemon games of all time. Even though people don't love Brilliant Diamond and Shining Pearl, I had fun playing these games again. Whilst they do have flaws, these games are still fun for what they try to be. I'm attached to a lot of Pokemon here, I'm really glad I actually made this video, and I'm just happy that people actually want to watch my videos. It means a lot to me, so I'll see you guys next time.